Hello all. In this lecture, we will be studying about the seismic waves and their measurement also. And we will see that what useful information we can have from the seismic waves about the actual geological phenomena which cause them. So let's start. We know that the earthquakes generate many seismic waves, or you can say the disturbance in the earth's crust. And that will be in many complex patterns. Some waves penetrate the earth and come to the surface in the same state or slightly distorted. The others are reflected or refracted or bent by something or some zone of different density within the earth itself. Some travel around the circumference of the world and do not penetrate at all. So they just remain on the surface. So, for example, here you can see the rays of seismic shear waves from the focus of the 1989 Loma Prieta earthquake through the earth's crust. So, this point here is the focus or hypocenter from where the seismic waves originate, and then you can see here that they travel in different directions in very complex patterns. Some directly go to surface and then some reflect back. Here you have the base of crust at around 25 km at that location. So some waves, when they reach to the interface between crust and mantle, they reflect back. Some waves, they just went into the mantle and they refract. Similarly, some waves, after several rounds of reflection, they reach to the certain location. So for example, Loma Prieta is the location at which the waves originate, and here you have San Francisco. At that particular location, you will receive waves which will be coming from different directions, and those will be some will be original waves, some will be distorted. Some will be distorted in more, you can say, manner, and some will be more close to the original waves. Some will be just coming from the interface of the mantle and crust, and some will have many cycles of reflections before reaching to a certain location. So this is a very complex pattern, and it is very difficult to actually, you can say, map that pattern. So these waves are classified into three types, the basic three types of seismic waves. One is the P waves, the primary wave. Then we have the secondary wave, and then also the surface wave. The P waves and secondary waves, these two are also sometimes called as the body waves. Body waves. Because they basically travel through the body of Earth to reach to a certain location on the surface. The surface waves, on the other hand, they just travel along the surface and then reach to any location on the surface. P waves are compressional waves which exert a push and a pull force, just like sound waves are longitudinal or compressional waves. The motion of a P wave is same as that of a sound wave. As it spread out, it alternately pushes and pulls the rock. The P wave, just like sound waves, are able to travel through both liquid as well as solid rocks. So the P waves can travel through molten rocks, magma, or it can also travel through oceans. On the other hand, S waves or shear waves or secondary waves, as it propagates through the body of rock, a shear wave shears the rock sideways at right angles to the direction of the travel. The P waves, they are their direction is parallel, the motion of the particles or rock is parallel to the direction of the wave propagation. But here, the motion of the rock will be perpendicular to the direction of wave. The S wave cannot propagate in liquid parts of the earth, such as oceans or magma. It can only propagate from the solid rocks. So here you have this this animation basically shows the difference between P waves and S waves and surface waves. So you can see P wave is a longitudinal wave, is a compressional wave. it is simply disturbing the material along the direction of the propagation. So any point or any area, you can see it is just undergoing a series of push and pull or compression or tension. Any point is moving in the parallel direction compared to the direction of the propagation of wave. S waves are not like that. In that, you will have the motion of any particle in that medium is perpendicular to the direction of wave. So this dot is moving up and down. Surface waves, on the other hand, they are only concentrated towards the surface of the earth. So these two, P waves and S waves, are sometimes called as the body waves because they travel not on the surface but from the body of the earth itself. So if you have undisturbed material, and then if you have the P wave in that, the material will be disturbed in this manner, that some material will be in compression, then tension, then compression, and then again tension. So it will be a series of compression and expansion, and through that compression and expansion, the disturbance will travel from one point to another. S waves, on the other hand, they will move the particles in the direction perpendicular to the motion. So if the wave is traveling in this direction, then the particles will move up and down. The surface wave itself has two types. One is called the Rayleigh wave and the other is the Love wave. The Rayleigh wave basically is a kind of a rolling motion on the surface, up and down. The particle will move up and down. So this surface wave, basically this animation, is in fact showing the first type of the surface wave. The second wave is called Love wave, the second type of surface wave, and in that case the particles are moving sideways. The particles moving in the lateral sideway direction as the wave propagates towards the right hand side. So this is a very complex kind of wave which basically shears the particles in lateral direction, perpendicular direction, compared to the direction of the propagation of wave. So both of these waves, they are concentrated towards the surface only, and they are called the surface waves. So some more discussion about body waves. For example, when the body waves, which means P and S waves, move through the layers of the rock in the crust, they are reflected or refracted at the interfaces between rock types. So if you have one rock type, let's say this is surface, and after some depth you have some interface between one rock type and the second rock type. So if the wave originates from here, at the interface, some part of it will reflect back, some will refract into the second, you can say, rock type. Whenever either one is reflected or refracted, some of the energy of one type is converted to waves of the other type. So whenever this interaction, at that particular interaction, the wave reflect or refract, it may change from one type to another type. P and S waves do not travel at the same speed. Generally, P waves have a higher speed compared to S wave. So although the speed vary with the substance through which the waves are passing, but generally the P waves have a high speed, the compressional waves have high speed compared to the shear waves or secondary waves. So at any particular site, you will expect that the P wave will arrive first and then the S wave will arrive later. The surface wave will have a velocity even less than S wave. So surface wave will be the last one to reach at a particular site from the same earthquake. The length of time between the arrival of the P and the S waves, it gives us an indication of how far the seismic waves are coming from, how far the actual source of the earthquake is compared to the observer or compared to the site. So even by using three or more seismograph stations, the recordings of these three seismic monitoring stations, it is possible to pinpoint where the earthquake occurred. We will show in the next few slides that using the data recorded at least three seismic stations, we can actually identify the epicentral location of that earthquake. And that is due to the fact that the distance, time distance between the arrival of P waves and the arrival of S waves, that difference in the time is a function of how far from the site the actual source is located. So we can tell that if that time difference is given, let's say 3 seconds or 5 seconds, that number can be converted into the distance from source to that particular site at which that recording is made. We will see that in a moment. The surface waves have their motion restricted to near the ground surface. So as the depth below the surface increase, the wave displacement decrease. So they are mostly concentrated towards the surface, and they are more slow compared to the body waves. So further, they can be of two types, Love waves and Rayleigh waves. The motion of a Love wave is essentially the same as that of the S wave that have no vertical displacement. So only lateral deformation, side wave movement. It moves the ground from side to side in a horizontal plane, but at right angle to the direction of propagation. So if the direction of propagation is this direction, the particle will be in this way and in that way. It will move in that direction, side to side, horizontal plane. Love waves do not propagate through water. The Rayleigh waves are like the rolling of ocean waves, where the pieces of material are disturbed and they move both in vertical as well as in the horizontal plane. And they move both vertically and horizontally in a vertical plane, pointed in the direction of which the wave is traveling. So if I go back to show you that animation here, you can see that the particles are, these Rayleigh waves are moving the particles in both vertical and horizontal directions, and mostly their movement is parallel to the direction of the propagation of wave. Their horizontal movement is parallel to the direction of propagation of wave. But the horizontal movement of the particles in Love wave are perpendicular to the direction of the propagation of wave, although both are surface waves. So let's come back to that point, that the difference between the P wave and S waves, the time difference, the time separation will give us, will indicate that how much far the actual source is compared to that particular site. So at any seismic station, we will record the actual shaking of the ground and the actual equipment, which may look like this figure. You can see here that this cylindrical equipment is basically having a seismometer, and it records the actual shaking of the ground on which it is installed. And that shaking will basically recorded in three perpendicular directions, X, Y, and Z, two horizontal directions and one vertical direction. And let's say that one of the horizontal shaking which is recorded under a particular earthquake is given by this graph, and in that graph, in Y direction is the actual shaking, the movement or vibration amplitude, which is in centimeters, you can see here. And on X axis is the time. So that's how we record a ground shaking in three perpendicular directions. So one of the lateral, you can say, component of that ground shaking is represented here by this line, this graph. The peak number is amplitude, this number. And you can see the arrival of different kinds of waves, the signature of different kinds of waves in that recording. So the movement will be almost zero, and it will start suddenly by the arrival of P wave. So when P wave arrive at your site where this equipment is installed, you will see that the vibration will start increasing, but the overall amplitude will be lower. Suddenly you will have the S wave. The S wave will arrive after P wave, and then you will start having big, you can say, amplitudes. and at the end, towards the end here, you will have the arrival of surface wave. Maybe here, this is the surface wave. So if we know the time difference between the arrival of P wave and S wave at a particular recording station, let's say this 2 second time separation, we can calculate the source to site distance. We can calculate that from where actually this seismic wave is basically reached to that particular station. The distance, we can calculate that distance. And that is easy. You can see here, for example, the velocity of the P wave can be written as the distance delta, the distance from the actual epicenter. Let's say this is the epicenter. The velocity of the P wave can be written as delta divided by, let's say, let's call it the time of P, TP. And similarly also you can say that the velocity of S wave is same delta, because the waves, both of them, are coming from the same point. And let's call it as TS, the time from where the S wave arrives. So for example, if we start the time from a particular location from here, let's say from here, so this time will be TP, and from the same point up to the arrival of S waves here, you this whole time will be TS, capital TS. So TS minus TP will be your let's denote is as TSP, which is the difference between the arrival of S waves and P waves. So all we can do is, from top here, we can simply write as TSP is equal to TS minus TP, and TS can be written as delta over VP. So delta over VP minus TP can be written as TS can be written as delta over VS, and TP can be written as delta over VP. So it will be delta over VP. So TSP is equal to delta over VS minus delta over VP, where VS and VP are the velocities of P waves and S waves, and TSP is the time separation or the distance between the arrival of P wave and the S wave. So from this equation, we can simply write delta as, so I write here, delta is equal to, from the equation on the top right, I can write delta is equal to simply TSP, which is the difference between P arrival, S arrival and P arrival, divided by 1 over VS minus 1 over VP. So if the velocities of S and P waves are given, and at a particular recording station, if from the recording we calculate the difference between P arrival and S arrival, we can calculate the delta, which is the source to site distance. So this figure basically gives us the recording of the same earthquake which is recorded at different recording stations. So these recording stations will be situated at different locations compared to the hypocenter. So 0 means that the hypocenter point, and 50 means that the distance between the hypocenter and the recording station is 50 kilometer, 100, 150. So there are different recording stations located at different distances from the hypocenter. So if you look at the recordings from all of these stations at this, for the same earthquake, which is in this case is the 1995 Kobe earthquake. So you can see here that the difference between the arrival of P wave and S wave is increasing as the distance, hypocentral distance, is increasing. So the difference between P arrival and S arrival at this particular station is more compared to the one which is located relatively close to the hypocenter. Similarly, the distance between, so this time difference is basically TSP, and that TSP is a function of the hypocentral distance. So it is reducing with as you are going for the stations which are closer to the hypocenter. These curves, if you join them, for example, all the P arrival, if you join them, these lines are basically called the distance time curves, and they are not straight lines, by the way. For larger, you can say hypocentral distances, they become curved lines, and they are called the distance time curves. Similarly, for S wave also, this blue line is the distance time curve. So this is that exercise. For example, here you have P arrival, and here on that record you have the S arrival. So if the distance between them is the TSP, then that can be used to come up with the same expression which I just showed you, that delta, which is the source to site distance, can be calculated. So this TSP is the, for any particular record, it is the difference of in time between the arrival of P wave and the arrival of S wave. So the difference between them, if that TSP is known, that delta can be calculated. So you can see here that this is a distance time curve or line, this is another distance time curve for S wave, this is for P wave. Since we know the relationship between velocity and the distance, so we can say that the slope of that distance time line or curve is the velocity. So Vp is higher, Vs is lower, but mostly they are known because they are the function of the density or rigidity of the rocks. So they are mostly known. So if we know Vs and Vp, we can calculate delta if the TSP is given. Same process can be repeated for three seismographs, and then you can even locate the epicenter also. So for example, you have three seismic stations here, which are represented with three red dots or blocks here. So we know already that the measurement of the PS time or TSP at a single location gives the distance between the station and the event. So we know that if, for example, this particular recording station, this one here, if the distance from the source is calculated equal to 4800 kilometer, so which means that the actual source of that seismic wave is located somewhere on a circle which have a radius equal to 4800. So if we have for the same ground motion or same earthquake event, we have the recording from another seismic station, and let's say that has a distance, that distance which is calculated from there is 2800 kilometer. In that case, we can draw another circle, and that the intersection of the two circles are the possible locations of the seismic source or the epicenter. So either the epicenter is located here at that intersection, and or this one. So if we have one more seismic station, we can plot another circle, we can draw that, and then finally the intersection of all three of them will actually give us the right location of the epicenter. So if we draw a circle on the map around a station's location with a radius equal to the distance which is calculated, that circle will be all possible locations of the event. But if we have a second station, the circle around that will narrow the possible locations to only two points. And if we have a third station and we do the same process, the circle around that will give us exactly the real location of the epicenter. So that's how we can use this TSP to actually locate the epicenter also, if we have the recording available for at least three recording stations for the same earthquake. So the seismic waves, as I mentioned, that they just refract also and reflect also. So for example, whenever there is a rock discontinuity or a boundary, the one type of rock with another density is meeting with another kind of rock with different density, the seismic waves will be either reflected or refracted also. I mean, some part of it will reflect, some part of it will refract. So here, for example, on top, if you have an earthquake focus, the seismic waves will originate at all the directions, but then some of them may just reflect at certain locations, some may just refract and move to other layers of the earth, and finally the site at which you are experiencing the earthquake, some of them will be just directly traveling like surface waves, some will be reflected from certain intersections or rock discontinuities or boundaries, some will be reflected and then reflected again to reach to your site. So it's a very actual process is very complex, but here it is just simplified representation of the path of different seismic waves which will be reaching at a particular recording station or at a site. And these seismic waves will follow the same laws of reflection and refraction which other waves follow. So the law of sine will hold, and here you know already that this theta 1 and theta 2 are the angles of you can say incidence and refraction, and C1 and C2 are the refractive index of the two layers. So C1 is the refractive index of this layer, this rock layer, and the C2 is the other one. So some part of it will be reflected into the same layer, but some part will be refracted into the other layer. So the laws of sine will hold in this case also. Sometimes there will be a series of different layers of rocks with different densities or different refractive indices. So there will be a series of refractions until the wave pass from one location or one layer to another one. So in order to highlight this reflection and refractions concept, this is the distance versus time graphs for the same recorded earthquake. This is for Sumatra Andaman Island earthquake, and this is the recordings, a series of recordings at seismic stations located at different distances from the actual source. So 20 kilometer, 40 kilometer, up to maybe 180. So if you plot all of them with the same time axis in this manner, you will see certain patterns. So for example, you can see here one pattern of peaks which is in this diagonal direction, then another pattern of peaks, this line you can see here, then another pattern of peaks which is traveling in this manner. So basically these are the reflected waves. So R1, R2, R3 and R4 are waves reflecting to and fro from some you can say boundary between two different layers of rocks, and therefore you will have peaks which are corresponding to these reflected waves. So for example, you see here that as we are moving with the distance axis, basically we are going away from the actual source of the earthquake, you can see here that the distance versus time graphs or lines for P and S waves are, you can say, you can plot them like this in this manner. So these will be your distance time curves or graphs for P and S waves. Maybe this is P, this is S, but then you have some discontinuity, maybe lying somewhere around 200 kilometer away from the epicenter or source, or maybe 220, that you have a reflected wave which is manifesting, or you can say you can see that in all of these recordings. So the recordings are almost showing very small amplitudes, but suddenly you have one peak, and the pattern shows that it is, this peak is basically coming from a wave which is reflected from a certain boundary between two different rock layers, maybe located at 200 or 190 or 220 kilometer from the actual source. And again you have in that recording you have another series of another peaks which are the reflected waves, and again you have another one, R4, a series of peaks, although the energy is being lost every time the wave is hitting to a certain boundary and then coming back. So amplitude is reducing with each reflection, but you can identify these reflected waves if you plot all of the recordings from one particular earthquake in this manner. So towards the end, let's discuss about seismoscopes, and these are the equipment or instruments used to detect and record ground motions. So let's start from a bit history of these development of these seismoscopes. In the year 136 AD, a Chinese called Choco, or in some texts you have his name as Chang Heng, he was the first one to invent an instrument for indicating earthquakes, basically just telling whether you have an earthquake or not. So it simply consisted of a spherically formed copper vessel like this, 2.4 meter in diameter. The inner part of this instrument, a column was there so suspended that it can move in 8 directions. So this whole vessel can move in 8 possible directions, and in each direction he installed this metallic dragon holding a metallic ball in its mouth, and then he also have these frogs which basically receive those balls. So these balls are basically in the mouths of those dragons, and the accuracy of formation of all of that equipment is so sensitive to the movement that whenever there is a motion or the vessel is shaken in horizontal direction, the dragon drops those balls and there will be a ringing sound because of those metallic balls, and everyone there can identify that we have an earthquake. So this was a simple idea, and this equipment can only detect earthquake, it cannot actually record that shaking. So once it was observed that the dragon dropped its ball, but without any earthquake being observed by the people who were there. Initially no one took it seriously, but once it happened that the actual equipment recorded or indicated a ground motion, but no one actually observed. But after 2 or 3 days, a notice came saying that an earthquake had occurred in a far off place, and here at that particular location no one observed it, but it was that small that the equipment was able to detect, but the actual observation was not there for a ground shaking. So then people start believing in this invention, and basically the government at that time asked the inventor to develop more of it, and then they appointed a secretary to make observations on earthquake. So this was an early history, or you can say the very first attempt of actually recording an earthquake. But the earliest modern seismographs were invented by John Mill around 1880s, when he was the professor of geology and mining at the Imperial College of Engineering in Tokyo. So the basic problem at that time was that how can we produce a body which would remain stationary during a ground shaking. So the idea is that if we can produce a mass, we can develop an equipment such that certain mass in that equipment remains stationary while the ground underneath that moves. So if that mass can be made stationary, then we can attach a pen with that mass, and that pen will basically record, it will still remain still during a ground motion, and it will record actually the actual shaking of the ground itself. It will not shake with the ground. So at that time they decided to use the mechanical principle of inertia. Inertia is the tendency of a heavy body to stay stationary while the surroundings are being moved. So what they did is that they developed an equipment which was essentially made of a pendulum, and the idea was that if we can detach the motion of the mass, this mass, if we detach its motion with the motion of the surrounding object, basically the ground motion, so therefore that mass will be able to record the actual shaking on paper. So they relied on these freely swinging pendulum whose movement were marked by pin or pen on a revolving drum of smoked glass or later paper. So this was the idea that they use the pendulum to actually detach a mass from the ground motion. But the problem is that the property of that pendulum also depends on how easily you can detach, or how efficiently basically you can detach the motion of that mass with the motion of the surrounding ground. So the earthquake does not make the pendulum swing. The idea should be that the earthquake should not make the pendulum swing. Instead, the pendulum should remain fixed as the ground moves. So a pendulum on the left hand side, you can see with a very short time period, it moves along with the support and registers no motion. If the pendulum's mass is moving with the ground, it will record no motion. So the idea is that you should have a pendulum which has a very long time period, just like the pendulum on the right hand side, and that pendulum will basically detach the motion of the mass with the motion of the ground. That mass will actually be able to record the ground motion. So a pendulum with a long period tends to remain in place while the support moves. The boundary between the two types of behavior is the natural period of the pendulum. You should have a pendulum with very high natural period so that the motion can be effectively detached, or the structure should remain still while the ground underneath it displaces. So only motions faster than the natural period will be detected. Any motion slower than the time period will not be detected. So in this figure you can see here that you are applying the same ground motion to both of the pendulums. This smaller one have a lower time period, lower t, and the longer one will have a large value of time period. So if the applied ground shaking, which is to be recorded, is very fast compared to the time period of the pendulum, only then it can be recorded, and only then can the motion be detached compared to that. So here you can see in the left hand side, the time period is such that it is matching with the ground shaking. The ground shaking is slow and the time period is also low. So they are matching, and therefore the mass, the yellow mass, is moving with the ground shaking. So it will not be able to record this ground shaking. On the other hand, the ground shaking is slow, but the time period is high. So that difference basically will be actually what is detaching the ground motion from the actual movement of the mass. So this difference should be high. So any motion slower than the time period will not be recorded. So it means that if you want to record a ground motion, a slow ground motion, you should have a pendulum with a time period which is very high. But if the ground shaking is very fast, like if I imagine that a ground motion which is 10 times or 15 times faster than what is shown here in this animation, then even in that case you can imagine that even the yellow ball will not be able to move that fast with the ground. So even the yellow pendulum was enough to record that ground shaking. But in this case, the current animation speed, you can easily observe that a very high time period, you can say, pendulum is required. So the seismograph is the equipment which is developed based on this idea that you should have a pendulum, and the time period of the pendulum is set such that any recording which is faster than that time period, that will get recorded in that. And that will be displacement type seismometer. A seismometer is a general equipment used to record seismic activity. But when we refer to seismograph, it means the displacement recording with time. So on y-axis you have the displacement of ground, and on x-axis you have time. So this kind of a, you can say, equipment which will give you this recording will be seismograph. The damping of the pendulum was also added to suppress the free vibration response and to improve the performance of the seismographs. This is to ensure that the dynamic behavior of the equipment itself will not affect the recording. So, John Mill seismographs, he employed three devices, one for each component of ground motion, which means up, down, north, south and east, west. So, two are the horizontal components, one is the vertical component. So, his equipment was basically able to record the ground movement in three perpendicular directions, x, y, x and y, and also in the z direction. So, instead of pendulum, you can also use the mass attached to a spring, and whenever the ground moves in up down direction, the movement of that mass should be detached from the movement of the holding assembly such that it will be able to record the actual up down ground motion. Similarly, for horizontal directions, you will have this kind of a setup in which the shaking will be recorded in this direction, horizontal direction. So this is the actual picture of the John Mills seismograph. He developed a number of seismographs, and one of them is this one. The modern seismographs, although they are basically using the same idea, the idea of a pendulum, but they use the smart materials, and mostly they are based on the production of electrical signal resulted from the movement of that mass. So I am not going to explain the actual principle, the working principle of a modern seismograph, but the idea is that the relative motion between the pendulum and the holding assembly or frame, that relative movement, it produces an electrical signal. So that electrical signal can be magnified electronically thousands or even hundreds of thousands of times before it is recorded. And now, instead of actually recording on paper, the electrical signals can be recorded to a magnetic tape, even on paper also, and it can be converted into digital signals and stored in computers. So modern seismographs directly give us the data, which is the time and the displacement of ground, and that will be in three directions, x, y and vertical direction, or in fact two horizontal directions and one vertical direction. So I will not go into that detail. You can refer to some standard textbook to understand the basic idea behind the actually production of the electrical signal, which is coming from the relative motion between the pendulum and the frame which is holding it. The whole assembly nowadays can be compacted in one small cylinder kind of an equipment, and that equipment can be installed to record the seismic activity. So these are the actual pictures from two different kinds of seismographs. One is called the short period seismograph. The natural period is 1 second, the natural period of the seismograph itself. So it corresponds to a very short pendulum having a time period which is very small, 1 second. But on the other hand, you have another one which is broadband seismograph, corresponding to a natural period of 120 seconds. Use of the smart materials and other modern technology, now it is possible to have the natural periods, very high natural periods, and develop these broadband seismographs. Remember that any shaking which is faster than this natural period, that will be recorded in that accurately. So which means that these short period seismographs will not be able to record a slow kind of a ground shaking. If the ground shaking is very slow in this direction, since its own natural period is very small, it will not be able to record, and you can assume that the pendulum will just move with the ground. Its motion will not get detached compared to the ground shaking. However, if that shaking is very fast, imagine that it is vibrating, the earth is vibrating in a very fast manner, then that motion will be detached, and then the mass will be able to record that ground motion. The broadband seismographs can, you can say, record almost all ground motions, because they already have a natural period which is 120 second, very high. So which means that the ground motions, most of them will have a shaking which is faster than this. So that will get recorded. So you can say here in short that the broadband seismograph has a wider range of ground shakings which it can record, but the short period one will record only those ground motions which are faster than this 1 second natural period. So most seismographs around the world are designed to detect small amplitude motions and are very sensitive ears on the world. They can detect and record earthquakes of small size with very great distances, maybe greater than 1000 kilometers. So they are very sensitive equipment which can record very small accelerations also. So just to give you an idea that if, for example, on x-axis you have the natural time period of the equipment itself and on y-axis you have the maximum acceleration which that equipment can install, can record basically. So if you have here in this range, so you will need a very high frequency seismometer, which means a very, you can say, low time period seismometer. So let me write it short period seismometer. So this is the range, you can say this time period range is the range in which the high frequency seismometer or short period seismometer, they will be useful in this very small range. The broadband seismometer will record the ground motions in a very broad range of time periods. So all of this range, whole range, is covered by the very broadband seismometers. On the acceleration axis, on y axis, you will see here that this is the lowest acceleration possible, this one, which an equipment can record. Below that is only low earth noise. Here you can see this red line is a kind of a boundary line between a low earth noise. So any acceleration lower than that red line is simply noise, and the broadband, very broadband seismometer and some short period seismometer can even record the acceleration lower than that low earth noise. So on y-axis you can see the range of the actual acceleration or the capability of different seismometers in recording the acceleration. So for very high accelerations here or towards the top, you can even use low gain seismometers and they will serve your purpose. But for lower levels of acceleration, very small accelerations, you may need high frequency or basically short period accelerometers, or you need very broadband seismometer, depending upon which range of expected ground shaking you are expecting, how fast or how slow. So in very broadband seismometers you can have, for example, all of these stars here are representing the magnitude of earthquake 5 and maybe 9.5 here, you can see. So which means that most of the earthquake activity can be covered by this very broadband seismometer, both in terms of the acceleration range, the acceleration recording range, as well as in the time period range. So this white area is basically the very broadband seismometer, or in fact it is the range of very broadband seismometer. So different international organizations have their seismographic network. For example, this is the Global Seismographic Network, GSN, by IRIS. IRIS is an organization, Incorporated Research Institutions for Seismology. It is a consortium of different organizations for seismology and its research. So they have several seismic recording stations, in fact a network of seismic stations, and that is represented here by this star, red star. So you can see here that they have installed their seismic monitoring stations on all around the globe. and they are almost uniformly distributed so that any seismic activity in the Earth's crust can be recorded and then can be analyzed. Strong motion seismographs are especially designed to record the strong shaking of ground in such a way that the records obtained can be directly read as acceleration of the ground. So instead of having the ground shaking as the displacement versus time, now we have the acceleration record directly using these strong ground motions, strong ground motion seismographs. So they may look like this, and they are very compact devices, and they are capable of recording directly the acceleration of the ground compared to the displacement. So the acceleration can then be integrated to velocity and also displacement also. So they will tell us that how much the acceleration of the ground greater than that of the gravity, which means that the acceleration values will be in the units of g, where g is the acceleration due to gravity. Most strong motion accelerometers do not record continuously. They are mostly in the sleep mode, and they are triggered by a motion when the first waves of the earthquake arrive and hit the station. They are just start recording and they are triggered. So there is a threshold value of acceleration which is set. If they experience an acceleration more than that, they will start recording the data. And why we need an acceleration of the ground directly? Because we know that the ground acceleration can be multiplied by the mass of the structure to directly calculate the earthquake forces. So these are the earthquake forces which are calculated by multiplying the ground acceleration with mass. So these forces can be applied to our structure, and our structure can be designed to sustain these forces. So that's why recording the ground acceleration directly is most useful for engineering purpose compared to ground displacement. We can integrate the ground acceleration to calculate ground velocity, and we can integrate it one more time to get the ground displacement. So the top graph here is the acceleration versus time for an example earthquake, then velocity, ground velocity versus time, and then ground displacement versus time. So one of an important index of seismic loading or parameter is the peak ground acceleration, or PGA. So this is the peak number experienced during a particular ground shaking or a particular ground acceleration. So this number will be called as the peak ground acceleration, PGA. This map shows the strong motion stations installed in Taiwan, and these are the Japanese Meteorological Agency seismic intensity for the 1999 Chichi earthquake. So this number is basically representing the intensity of an earthquake, how intense or how less intense it is by a number. Obviously 3 means less intense and 6 means more intense. So you can see here that all of these dots, which are the seismic stations, and the color is showing the intensity at each seismic station. So you can see here that this is the epicenter, and all of the dots around that are red in color, showing a very high intensity. And as you are moving away from that epicenter, the intensity is decreasing. So this intensity is calculated from a 3-component acceleration record. So the recording station records the data during that particular Chichi earthquake, and then it is analyzed to get the intensity number, and then each recording station, the color of that is showing the intensity of that particular earthquake. So here another example, you have one earthquake which is locating here, and this is the epicenter, and these are all the recordings recorded at different stations. This recording is from a magnitude 5 earthquake in 1998. The vertical axis is acceleration and the horizontal axis is the time. So you can see here that the stations which are located close to the epicenter, they have recorded a high acceleration values. And as you are moving away from the epicenter, the acceleration values are reduced. But not only the acceleration values are reduced, but you can also observe that the frequency content of the recorded ground motion is also modified for different stations. And that depends on what kind of soil on which that station is installed. So here, for example, you can see an earthquake. You can observe that now here, or maybe here, you may see that there are several peaks in the ground shaking. But if you go to the stations which are closer to the epicenter, the peaks are lesser, although they have a very high, you can say, amplitude. So, for example, you see here that this particular record, it shows a very low acceleration values. But a station which is lying far from the epicenter compared to the first one is showing relatively higher values of acceleration. So in general, we know that the acceleration is reducing, but the individual ground motions also record the signature of the actual site conditions or soil conditions on which it is installed. So it is possible that at this second station, the local soil have a tendency to amplify the ground motion. And the first one, maybe the local soil is stiff enough to de-amplify or reduce the effect of ground motion. So therefore, although we know that in general the amplitude is reducing by increasing the distance, the local effects of the soil will also modify the recording of that shaking, and its effect will be it can be seen in that recording also. So the frequencies of the signal which is recorded for the same ground motion will be different for different stations depending upon what path is followed by the seismic waves to reach to that station and what was the properties of the local geology or properties of the rocks from which the seismic waves pass. So I will end this session here, and then I will see you in the next session. In that, we will be discussing about the size of an earthquake, how we can quantify the damage potential or intensity of an earthquake or magnitude of an earthquake. So till then, stay safe and see you. Thank you.